Hello and welcome to The Big Picture. The bugles have been sounded for the battle for Bihar. The polling will be held in five phases between October 12th and November 5th, with the results to be declared on November 8th. With the main contenders for power, the ruling JDU, RJD and Congress combined, already decided on their seat share, their main rival BJP-led alliance is yet to finalize the seat sharing. Meanwhile, the opinion polls have started coming out, with two such polls coming yesterday. While one poll gave a clear, simple majority to BJP combined, the other one saw JDU, RJD, Congress combined closer to the majority. There'll be some more polls coming in the days and weeks to come. However, with the lines drawn clearly and the incumbent Chief Minister Nitish Kumar fighting to retain his position, the stakes are very high for all the parties. Prime Minister Narendra Modi has put his personal stakes in this battle. And for him and his party, President Amit Shah, it will be a crucial elections. If they pull it off, their personal clout will increase, which is crucial after the Delhi elections debacle. For Lalu Prasad Yadav, who cannot be in the electoral fray, it is virtually a battle for survival. So today we will look at what holds for all the players in this battle, which will also decide not just the political fate of Bihar, but for the country too. To discuss this, I have with me Dr. Sanjay Kumar, Director CSDS and also a Psephologist, Neelabh, Mishra, Editor Outlook Hindi, Dr. Manoj, a Political Analyst and also a Spokesperson of RJD, and Venkitesh, Ramakrishnan, Associate Editor of the Frontline. Welcome to all of you. Sanjay, when we look at the election results of 2014 Lok Sabha, it was quite evident from the way it turned out that caste was not so much of a factor in that election, and development was a major factor which seems to have decided the way it was decided. You think now we are back to caste as a main factor?
Certainly, if we look at the results or the voting patterns in 2014 Lok Sabha election, there was some kind of a departure if we compare it with the past.
Yes.
Caste was not that important a factor, and development did trump the caste-based voting. I don't see that happening in 2015 election because stakes are different. 2014 election was only for electing the parliament, having a prime minister, and people had, at that time, there was a euphoria in favor of Narendra Modi. Things have changed dramatically now. It's kind of a referendum on Nitish Kumar as the election is turning out to be in Bihar. So, and the way the two formations have formed alliances, I can clearly see that voting will take place largely on caste-based affiliation of political parties. So caste-based voting is going to come back in a big way in 2015 assembly elections.
Okay, that's a interesting way to start with. Manoja, would you agree with that?
I would fundamentally disagree with that because I have been maintaining this position that binary of caste versus development comes only to Bihar. I mean, that's unfair to Bihar. In fact, if we talk about that, why there are caste-based, problems of access, opportunity, it should not be considered as a kind of speaking for the casteist politics or caste-based affiliations coming to the fore. That is
Manoj,
number one. Number two.
Sorry. Sorry to intervene, Manoj. I want you to wear the hat of a political analyst, not as an RJD spokesperson when we are discussing today, because I don't have anybody from any other political party panel today.
Girish ji, I promise I will not. And because of my commitment, I said, even in my writings, even in my classroom discourse, I always maintain that don't put caste versus development. Talking about, ask a simple question. 52.6% people in this country are landless. We are simply asking, please have a correlation established in the public domain that people belonging to a particular caste have little hold or no hold at all on land. That is number one. This is asking for development to have a broad base. Number two, I think we also miss that this is no more an election in Bihar. And I disagree with Sanjay ji that it is ironically, I don't know why, but it is not a referendum on Nitish ji. Nobody is discussing Bihar politics. People are talking about the national narrative of development, what Modi ji has built, That has become the talk of every village, nook and corner. And there I find that it is no more a battle in Bihar. It's a battle through Bihar. And that is the beauty of this election.
Manoj,
all the alliances should also be seen from this prism.
Yeah, yeah, please finish. Please finish, Manoj.
Any question?
No, please finish. You finish.
No. That's what I said. And finally, I'll say that this election also is witnessing a churning in terms of social justice. I mean, social justice is a dynamic concept. It should not be confined only to reservation. It should broaden itself, particularly in times when a state is shrinking in terms of its commitment to core social sector initiatives. I mean, these are the kind of issues with the dominant media in Delhi probably does not capture, and which is going on in Bihar.
Okay, I think you have made a point. Yes, Sanjay, would you like to react?
No, I was saying that if it is not a different political parties would have different stand on how to contest go into this election. I'm sure Nitish Kumar and his party is going into election with the development agenda like what Nitish Kumar has been able to do during last 5-10 years. If that's not the case, then I would have agreed with Manoj that this is a referendum on the work done by Modi. But work done by Modi would be a referendum for the BJP. But for JDU, they are campaigning aggressively in this election, saying this is what has been done by Nitish Kumar. So I see this election as a referendum on the work done by Nitish Kumar, as JDU want this election to be held.
And the other point which Manoj made about caste not being a factor.
I would let election takes place and you figure out whether people were sharply divided on caste lines or not.
Okay. Venkitesh, you have just traveled through some of the places in Bihar. What is your impression of that in the light of what we have just heard from both Sanjay and Manoj?
I would say that, you know, that it is not a straitjacketed development versus caste issue. It is not a direct contest between development or caste. It is a mixture of very many factors. Certainly there is this issue of continuation of Nitish Kumar's regime.
Partly it's a kind of a referendum.
It's partly a kind of referendum on Nitish Kumar. It is also, I mean, increasingly, as you travel across, I mean, some parts of Bihar which I've traveled now, what you see at this point of time is, you know, increasingly there is a discussion about what Narendra Modi promised in the 2014 Lok Sabha elections, what he promised specifically for Bihar, and how he has, you know, chosen to deliver it. I mean, if at all he has delivered
it. So the package, that yeah. huge package, has become an issue in the election?
It's a double-edged sword because, you know, the way it has been announced, I think Modi and the BJP are not able to capitalize on it if they had announced it a little earlier. If they had actually gone about it in a systematic manner, they would have been able to make better political capital out of it. So now all these issues, Nitish Kumar's referendum, the issue of Modi's governance of the last 1 year, the kind of promises that he made for Bihar, and overarchingly, the issue of the caste equations. I think, you know, it's a combination of all these factors. One cannot just say that it is one factor. If you look at the Bihar 2014 elections, right, it was Modi versus the rest, and Modi's image as the development person, and also some impact of the communal polarization that was there in Uttar Pradesh. This time, I think it's a combination of all these factors, and one needs to say where and how all these factors will, in what proportion they will impact.
The okay. Yeah. Neelabh, you know, 2014 Lok Sabha elections, it was very clear it was Modi versus the rest. Is 2015 also Modi versus the rest?
No, it's not Modi versus the rest, because, you know, that rest alliance is a bit broken. You have Majhi shifting over to Modi's side.
Yes.
And BJP is carefully building those alliances.
No, but, you know, so more or less, if you see the 2014 alliance of BJP,
I would say, and now, if you look at it in personality terms, then it's not Modi versus the rest. It's Modi versus Nitish and Lalu. And at the national level, if you look at the big picture, it's Modi versus Nitish. At the local level, it's Modi versus Nitish and Lalu.
So Lalu is also a major factor there?
He is a major factor.
Okay. So if it is Modi versus Lalu, and Nitish, so what is it? that Modi cannot be, actually Prime Minister Narendra Modi cannot be identified in terms of caste. So to that extent, it you know, how does it play out?
I wish he was not identified with a particular caste, but the way campaigning is taking place, the way his caste has been named in couple of rallies or by the BJP workers in the state, it's not Modi is being presented as the Prime Minister of the country, but he's also presented as a leader representing one particular caste, that is the OBC.
So that's very interesting what you're saying. So it is OBC versus OBC. It's on the other side also, they are OBCs.
Yeah, look at various castes, the way they are taking sides. Upper caste Dalits on one side, two groups within the OBCs, Yadavs, Kurmis and Muslims on one side. So the game changer is going to be the large number of MBC, what we call most backward caste. They are in sizable numbers, approximately rough estimates, 26-27% of the total voters. And they are going to be the game changer. So the idea is who is going to influence them more, who is going to attract them more. Whichever way they are going to shift, I think election will shift in that direction.
Manoja, would you agree with that? Or you have a problem with this also?
No, I would agree. I mean, in fact, it is very interesting that the Prime Minister himself was the first one who discovered his caste, probably for the first time.
I've
been following him since 2002. He discovered on the plains of Bihar that he belongs to the OBC. So this entire fiction of caste versus development and we'll fight on development, RJD-JDU alliance have nothing but caste. But interestingly, Girish, I'll also tell you something which is part of the local discourse in Bihar. You know, when leaders stitch alliance, they forget that there is a, particularly in certain Magad area, this talk is going on that how can the support base of Jitan Ram Majhi ji or Paswan ji stand in the same queue on every booth with the party which has major contribution in the birth and genesis of Ranveer Sena. I mean, this is something which Delhi media doesn't know, but popular folk communication is going on this. So this aspect is also cannot be looked at, overlooked.
So fine, that cannot be overlooked as the campaigns, you know, goes on, as the days and weeks go on before the elections. I'm sure this will become a major issue. This will be a talking point. It's already a talking point in certain circles. But Manoj, are you conceding when you're saying this, and that as far as the RJD, JDU, Congress combine is concerned, the upper castes are virtually out of their hold?
Girish ji, that's why I have been saying that I also, Sanjay ji, in fact, he's the master of the data, he knows. But we also do at some level. I would concede rather that the major chunk for us comes from a set of particular communities. But look at everywhere, there is a splinter of 15, 16, 18%, which even from upper caste we get. And we have been getting consistently. And I tell you, I mean, we cannot overlook the fact that there are sections whose ideological commitment also decides their voting behavior. Because what we do, most of the time when we put Bihar in the barracks of different caste, Bihar appears to be distant from the national narrative, which is not the case. Even Bihar feels, and at times it does, transcend caste barrier. I mean that has been seen.
I'm sure it does.
I can give you at least 50 constituencies last assembly election where we got upper caste, significant upper caste vote.
Okay.
Which election you are talking about, Manoj? See, I can tell you for sure, 85-86% of upper caste are going to vote for BJP alliance. JDU alliance will not be able to get even 10% of upper caste vote. This election will witness the sharpest polarization of upper caste in favor of BJP alliance.
I assure you that in each constituency, not less than 15-18% upper caste vote will come to this alliance. And we can have a debate on it.
Yeah, I think both of you are agreed on this, because he's talking of 85%. You're claiming 15%. So I think both of you agreed on it. No, but Sanjay, before I come to you, Venkitesh. Sanjay, when you talk of a sharp polarization, when castes voting in favor of certain parties, how much, what is the percentage, you think is the bottom mark where above which you can say that there has been a voting on one side?
See, on one point, Manoj is right that when we talk about caste and voting, we always tend to think
never
that
100%.
We tend to think that it is only happening in Bihar. It happens in all the states.
Right.
The sharpest polarization till few years back, we used to find among the Jatavs of UP who used to vote in about 80-85% for Mayawati.
Right.
Last 2014 elections actually witnessed the sharpest polarization of the upper caste in Bihar for BJP, which was close to 88-87%.
Okay.
But normally, when we say it's a vote bank, one caste is a vote bank for a political party, we would say 60-65% is a reasonable number, and that's the size up to 70, it goes up to 70-72%, and that's the number Lalu Yadav's party has been getting among the Yadavs for last several years.
So, Venkitesh, do you see that happening this time also, this kind of polarization?
There is no doubt about it. I mean, I think he's actually on the ball when he says that, you know, that this election is going to witness maximum polarization, especially from the upper caste. And also, I think it is very correct to say that the elections is primarily being fought between the upper caste and the OBCs, the majority, the predominant OBCs. And finally, the tilting factor would be the most backward castes, which account for some 26-27% of the total vote.
So, Neelabh, these most backward castes, what do you think will swing their votes now? Where do they stand?
No, let me add on this MBC thing, because, you know, MBC is a constituency which Nitish Kumar had very, very assiduously cultivated.
Right, and built it actually.
And built it up. And 2014, of course, like all the other political constituencies built up by various other parties, it all collapsed. This time, the sense that I'm getting is that a large, significant segment of the most backward caste are still with Nitish Kumar. But the departure of Jitin Ram Manji, who is close to the MBC caste, he's a Dalit who is close to the MBCs. So there are certain segments of the MBCs which have been affected by this shift of Jitin Ram Manji. The fact that Lalu Prasad Yadav belongs to an other backward caste, which has been generally seen as an oppressor of many of the MBC castes.
Right.
So all these factors are working, but it's too early to say. I think ultimately a big factor would be the way the Grand Alliance is able to finalize the candidates. If they're able to kind of accommodate the MBCs in a big way in the candidates list, I think the faith of the MBCs in Nitish Kumar and his leadership will continue.
Neelabh, would you agree with that?
MBCs is a very tricky question, you know, in my opinion. And having seen BJP's play among MBCs, not only in Bihar, but elsewhere in the country, Rajasthan, Gujarat, UP, you know, in a number of places. Look, what happens is BJP has a particular way of dealing, Sangh Parivar has a particular way of dealing with the caste question. What they do is they create local myths out of castes, you know. So you have, and they put them, it's a whole process of Sanskritization. They take some regional god.
Regional
spiritual figure, somebody
or
from
create,
that particular,
or create one.
For instance, among the Gujars in Rajasthan, there is Raja Bhagwan Dev Narayan Ji, you know, who is now an avatar of Krishna. And who is then, you know, then he gets a place in the Hindu pantheon. And it's a pantheon based on hierarchy. But, you know, but then Krishna is, of course, at the top of that hierarchy in the case of Dev Narayan. But Dev Narayan would be accommodated somewhere in the hierarchy. A. B. In Bihar also we have noticed this. You know, last time, I mean, it began with Betia riots. For instance, those riots began with what you call Mahaviri Akhadas. You know, so these are MBC caste people. And they were then, I mean, they show their martial art skills during that period when Mahavir Jayanti is held. And they made it, the BJP turned it into a competition between, you know, the Tajia procession.
Okay.
And the Mahaviri Akhada procession. They had done it in Jharkhand earlier. If you look at this whole Ram Navmi festival, you know, Ram Navmi Julus was never taken out anywhere in India. But Ram Navmi Julus became a major factor. Similarly, the Kanwar of Vaidyanath Dham in Bihar has now been replicated everywhere in North India. Yes. So now you have people traveling from Rajasthan, Gujarat, up to Haridwar with Kanwars. And it has become, so that is the means of organization of these castes. Now that has been happening. And it is, what the BJP did was during Nitish Kumar's reign, as and a coalition partner.
As a partner.
They utilized these spaces. And even I mean, the whole saffronization project was there with Ganga Aarti, you know. Ganga Aarti was a never a traditional religious spectacle in Patna, you know. But Ganga Aarti has become a major spectacle. And in the name of tourism, sometimes even
so,
people fall for it.
Neelabh, what you're trying to say is that there have been this process.
These small processes going on in Bihar for 5 years. So what you see as a BJP surge now is, I mean, sometimes we mistake, I mean, because of the media-driven discourse, we think it's Narendra Modi's surge. No. I mean, there is a whole groundwork behind it.
Very hard work which has been done.
Yeah.
Very hard work which has been done.
And this is a typical attempt to, you know, make a dent into the sea change in politics, in power structure in Bihar, which happened during the 1990s.
That's very interesting.
Yeah.
But I have another question related to this, but let me get Manoj wants to react. Yes, Manoj?
No, I am completely in agreement with probably Neelabh ji was speaking. We have been watching it and we had been warning, I mean, even when we had no relationship with Nitish ji. But I assure you that we have learned from our defeat. And at Marineval, hame pata hai ki humko zameen pe bhi ladna aur aasman pe bhi ladna. We know we are pitted against a very strong adversary who have no dearth of money and other resources. But believe us, we have taken all safeguards and will not allow any kind of scuffle between communities, between caste groups, till the time we are not able to build a total, the election should pass very peacefully.
Okay.
That we have done.
Okay. That, but it's not just about elections passing peacefully, but Sanjay, you know, the point which Manoja made earlier.
Otherwise also.
Manoja made a very important point. He said that, you know, this... both of you are agreed that as far as the upper caste votes are concerned, the upper caste will include the Brahmins, the Rajputs, the Bhumihars and all this. But they are seen as the oppressors as far as the MBCs and, you know, the Dalits are concerned. But still, you see some kind of a amalgamation taking place in favor of the BJP combined.
So I have a little disagreement on that. Upper caste, at least during last 10-15 years, the MBCs, the Dalits, might see the upper crest of the OBC as bigger oppressor compared to the upper caste.
Okay.
And that is why the chances of OBCs and Dalits going along with BJP, if going along with the upper caste voters who are going to vote for BJP, is much, much higher compared to the MBCs voting in favor of...
Is this a new trend?
At least during last 10-15 years.
In the last 10-15 years, The Ranveer Sena factor, let us call it the Ranveer Sena factor. The Ranveer Sena factor has not worked as far as keeping these two away. That's what you're trying to say in the last 10, 15
years? What I'm trying to say, like, when power came in the hand of OBCs in the early 90s, when Lalu Yadav became the chief minister, these MBCs had hope that it will trickle down to them and they would also get some share in political power, which didn't happen for the first 15 years of RJD's rule. They had some expectation that something might change when Nitish is in command. I don't think they were fully satisfied with the way things moved during that time. So their hopes and aspiration from this upper crest of OBC who had held the power for the last 25 years, they didn't see anything happening in their favor. So now they are looking forward to the upper caste. Maybe something might happen when BJP comes to power. That's their attraction towards BJP. Things will happen or not, we don't know.
Yeah, I would look at it in a more nuanced manner. I mean, it's a fact that if you look at entire North India,
not just Bihar,
but then if you look at UP as well, the Dalits have their most pressing problems or their sense of oppression, the most pressing oppression is with the immediate...
Higher community,
other backward caste. Especially in both these states, it's the Yadav community is seen as the primary oppressor. The fact that Nitish Kumar belonged to a community which was not numerically large, and was in association with the BJP, which is considered to be a party of the upper caste. That was one of the factors that made the MBCs gravitate towards Nitish Kumar. I mean, that's one of the factors that contributed. So this upper caste, lower caste thing is not watertight, or it's not a straitjacketed thing again. It has got many nuances and, wheels within wheels. So it is easier for the MBC and the Dalit to kind of gravitate towards the upper caste in spite of the Ranveer Sena, which is essentially a Bhumihar phenomenon.
Absolutely. Yeah. Neela.
Look, I would look at it.
I'll come to you, Manoj.
Yeah. A bit historically. I mean, this has always been the case. Yeah. I mean, whenever alliance, Indira Gandhi was a practitioner of this art. You remember Belchi. That time it was Nitish Kumar's caste which had perpetrated atrocities on the Dalits there. And Indira Gandhi exploited it to the hilt. Then when first anti-reservation stir came in Bihar during Karpuri Thakur's reign, it was 1978, when Karpuri Thakur enforced reservations in Bihar, then the slogan of the upper caste was, led by Satyen Narayan Sinha, who later joined, who was then in Janata Party and was a Rajput leader, and also the Congress people, the slogan was "Forward Harijan Bhai Bhai, Pichdi Jat Kahan Se Aayi." You know, so this has always been the case. And there have been moments in, because of peculiar circumstances in history, when this alliance has worked, but it broke down in the 1990s. It broke down. And for the first time, we saw a surge of support for Lalu Yadav, also among the Dalits, For instance, not the upper crust of Dalits. Chamars were with the Congress or with the left. But then, say, Musahars, Majhi's caste. Musahars in a big way. I mean, and there were symbolic gestures on Lalu Yadav's part, And even when the earlier alliance, I am talking of Karpuri Thakur's time, Karpuri Thakur's base was not just Yadavs and Kurmis, but it was also the MBCs. Yeah.
It has been a
socialist base, okay, and left base. Look, what I am trying to say is, but you need a gravity, a pull. I mean, a village is settled either by an upper caste or by a dominant caste.
Right.
Jats and Yadavs in the case of UP, Yadavs and Kurmis in the case of Bihar, So sometimes some of the MBCs, gravitate towards these dominant castes and some gravitate against them.
Against them.
So electoral politics is an interplay of these things.
Okay. I mean, yes, Manoj, very quickly, we're running out of time. Last words to you.
I'll just take two, three. No, but I mean, last word should be with you. Now, what I wanted to convey, that my panelists who are sitting there, their entire confinement is to Magadha belt. If I take you to Kosi and Mithila, you will get a very different picture. Now, secondly, I'll tell you, this entire idea of MBC gravitating towards upper caste and joining BJP in large chunk, it's a myth. It's a myth probably being perpetuated by some people who do not have any idea of the ground reality. I tell you, there is a coalition which is natural. We might have fought each other. There are differences between MBCs and Yadavs in certain locality. But then there is a naturalness attached to it. Whereas what BJP represents is coalition of contradiction. So when it comes down to a liquid kind of situation where fluidity is there, you have choice in favor of natural alliance and not for a coalition of contradiction.
Okay. I think on that note, we need to end. We will have many more discussions on this. I'm sure all of you will get more opportunities to expand on this. And then, I'm sure people will go to the other areas which you are talking about and hope and see what actually is happening on the ground. Anyway, this is the first of the discussions which we'll continue to have over the next 1.5 months till the results come out. Thanks to all my guests. Please keep watching. We'll come back with another issue in the big picture. Same time on Monday. And meanwhile, have a great weekend.